Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. My name is Pastor Rich Gates. I was here a couple of weeks ago, and I'm happy to be back with you again this weekend, this Sunday morning for worship. Just a couple of notes on worship as we begin this morning. The gospel, as it does through this Year A series, continues to get longer as we go through Lent, and so I invite you to remain seated for the gospel today for that reading. We begin this morning with the anniversary of baptism, and so as we begin to sing our opening song this morning, "We Are Baptized in Christ Jesus," I would invite anyone who's here for the anniversary of their baptism to join me near the font. When God claimed these beloved young people in holy baptism, we made special sacred promises. Parents promised to faithfully bring our children to worship,
to teach them the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments, and to place in their hands the Holy Scriptures, and to provide for their instruction in the Christian faith.
Sponsors and godparents in this congregation promised
to nurture them in the Christian faith and to support them and pray for them in their new life in Christ.
Today, we keep and renew our promises.
Okay, and if you all are turned back, how fitting in front of this beautiful stained glass to be faced back here. So as I read, please dip and place a cross on your children at the appropriate place in the litany. First of all, that you may hear to good news of Christ, the word of life. If you would dip and receive the sign of the cross on your ears. That you may see the light of Christ illuminating your way. Receive the sign of the cross on your eyes. That you may sing the praise of Christ, the joy of the church, receive the sign of the cross on your lips. That God may dwell within you by faith, receive the sign of the cross on your heart. that you may bear the gentle yoke of Christ in serving. Receive the sign of the cross on your shoulders. That God's mercy may be known in your works, receive the sign of the cross on your hands. That you may follow in the way of Christ, receive the sign of the cross on your feet.
Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will have the light of life." Okay. I invite you to light your candles in.
I'm going to have to get a light off of you. It did. I will. I'll light it with this. It might be out of oil.
Let us join together in the Apostles' Creed, the creed of our baptisms. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
When you were baptized, an assisting minister handed your parents a candle, maybe the candle that you are now holding, and said,
"Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven."
We are proud that you are part of
God's family and workers with us in the kingdom of God.
Before we pray, I just want to share a brief word with you. Today we're going to hear some of the invitation of Jesus. He's going to invite us to come and see, and we're going to hear the words to come and see. And so as you're holding your candles or your candles are near you, I'm going to ask you to remember that light as we proceed through worship this morning. And whenever you hear "come and see," remember your baptism through the worship this morning. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the new life you give us through holy baptism. Especially we ask you to bless each of these young people on the anniversary of their baptism. Continue to strengthen them with the Holy Spirit and increase in them your gifts of grace. The spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, who gives us a new birth by water and the Holy Spirit and forgives us all our sins, strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share the peace with one another and with all of our Christian brothers and sisters.
God's peace.
May peace be with you.
Remember, light the candle.
God's peace. I wonder if it's out of oil.
Peace be with you.
I'm guessing.
God's peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. God's peace be with you. Peace be with you. God's peace be with you. Peace be with you. God's peace be with you. Peace be with you.
God's peace.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, your Son came into the world to free us from sin and death. Breathe upon us the power of your Spirit, that we may be raised to new life in Christ and serve you in righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading for today is from the 37th chapter of the book of Ezekiel. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out of the Spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. There were very many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live. And you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I had been commanded, and as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them. But there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived, and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live. And I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. The second reading is from the book of Romans, the 8th chapter. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh. You are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also, through his Spirit that dwells in you. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after hearing that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble because the light is not in them." After saying this, he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right." Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought that he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you. And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench, because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me. But I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" And the dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. The Gospel of the Lord. April is here, and although we are experiencing a little bit of showers, a little more over in Joplin this morning where I came from than here today so far, although we are experiencing some showers, our readings make no mention of April showers nor coming May flowers. Instead, we get illness. We get bones. We get grief. And we get death. In the valley of the dry bones, death is pervasive. It's all present everywhere. And while there are many who can read Ezekiel 37 as somewhat beautiful, even sometimes musical, it is also horrifying. It is horrifying because it calls out for us to remember and to confront, to testify to the devastating events that led to all those dry bones being there in the first place. The landscape of skeletons, it didn't come out of nowhere. It was the result. It was the result of torture and siege warfare. It was the result of famine and disease and despair. It was the result of the destruction of cities and the demolition of places of worship. It was the result of killing, of murder, of terrorism. It was the result of lies, of power seeking to grab on to more power, of abuse, of one group turning against another. And then, in the village of Bethany, death fills that space as well. When Jesus arrives, he enters into their time of grief, into their mourning, into their pain, and even into their very, very deep anger. Yes, anger. Whether it's the result of illness, accident, or despair, when death strikes the people we love, we almost inevitably try to find a reason, a responsible party, a person or a people upon which to lay blame. We become angry. It's in our human instinct. John's account of the death of Lazarus demonstrates that that impulse is ages old, following the death of her brother, Martha. And then Mary too. They both approach Jesus saying, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." They are angry. And it's not just Martha and Mary. When Jesus at last goes to the tomb where Lazarus is laid, other family and other friends of the man, they murmur, "Could not he who have opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Their message for Jesus was not subtle at all. "You could have done better, Jesus. You should have known better. You should have loved us better. This death did not have to happen. It did not have to happen to Lazarus. It didn't have to happen to us." Their words underscore deep questions for the community. For the community of Bethany, questions for this community as well. If Jesus is truly present, if the water of the Spirit, the living water, the water of healing, the water of baptism that we began with, if it truly brings eternal life, as promised to Nicodemus, as promised to the woman at the well, and as promised to the man born blind, then shouldn't death be an anomaly? Shouldn't death be vanquished? Shouldn't death be no more? Yes, the questions still remain in our community. Why is there still death among us? Why does God allow it? Is Jesus absent? Has God left us? But before we even begin to ask those questions, Jesus is already beginning to answer them. We hear it at the moment when Jesus first learns of Lazarus' illness. He assures his disciples in that moment, the illness does not lead to death. It's a statement. It's a statement that to our eyes, to our human experience, seems to be very, very contrary to the surrounding facts, doesn't it? Lazarus' illness does lead to his death. On top of that, the illness, well, it will soon lead to Jesus' very own death as well. According to John, it is Jesus' raising of Lazarus that becomes the last straw. It is the act which results in Jesus' arrest, trial, and crucifixion. The raising of Lazarus brings Good Friday. So what is it that Jesus really means today? Jesus' words and actions, well, they can only apply that whatever we as humans understand of death, it is not that understanding that is permanent. As God sees it, as Jesus sees it, death does not last. Death is temporary. It is like sleep. Jesus does not speak euphemistically here to the one who declares to all, "I am the resurrection and the life." Death certainly can have no more permanence than sleep. But to the disciples, to us as disciples, well, Jesus' description of sleep can be both cryptic and confusing. I don't blame those there in Bethany at all for their misunderstanding of Jesus' words. The words for death that our own culture today encourages and sometimes, well, often frequently uses can be just as confusing, right? Mom, he's gone, we might say. What does that mean? In the obituary, we read, she passed away on Friday. God called them home, a poet writes. Yes, sometimes we too need to hear it in the plainer language that Jesus provides. Lazarus is dead. Stinking dead, rotting dead, wrapped up in grave cloths and buried in a tomb, dead, no more breath in him, valley of dry bones, dead. And what does Jesus then say? I am glad I was not there so that you may believe. Let us go to him. Come and see, in other words. And as he has done before, Jesus issues that invitation so that you may believe. Come and see Lazarus. So that you may believe. Come and see death. Let's not hide from it. Let's not pretend it doesn't happen. Let's not deny the grief and the pain and the weeping. But let us go and see. And out of this experience, you will believe. You will believe because death is not victorious. Yes, human death is real, but it does not conquer. Even death, in the end, serves the purposes of God, and that purpose is to bring all believers, all who hear the invitation to come and see, into union with God, through the one who is resurrection and who is life. This community is no stranger to illness, disease, and death. I know I am a guest among you, and I do not know you very well, but I do know that you are no strangers to illness, disease, and death. There are family, there are friends who are ill among you. There are loved ones who have died. I see them listed in your prayers that we'll soon share. And it goes beyond that, too. I know there are the many other deaths that we experience. Words shouted in hate, an angry silence, a paralyzing fear, hopeless anxiety, depression, all those things that we confess, things we have done, things we have left undone. I know that we know death. But we are not alone. We are not alone in that knowledge or in that experience. We are not alone. Just as Jesus knew and named the death of Lazarus, Jesus knows and names and sees the death in our own lives, the stink, the rot, the suffocating lack of air, the things that bind us up. Jesus knows it. And still he comes to us. Still he comes to us. He comes to us, both deeply moved and disturbed in spirit. Yes, he comes. And he gently says, "Show me where. Show me where." Today, gathering here, gathering together in this place around this font, one in community, one in body, with division erased, we are given the voice to respond, "Lord, come and see. Come and see us in all of our vulnerability. Come and see us in our death, our pain, our grief, our regrets. Come and see, Lord." And united with us, united with humanity, united with all of God's creation, Jesus does answer that invitation. He comes and he sees and he even weeps with us. And then he, the one who declares, "I am the resurrection and I am the life," he turns it all around and he invites us. He raises us. "Take away the stone," he says. "Take away the stone and come out from death. Come out, come out, come out. Come out from the darkness and see and believe." The Gospel of John is all about invitation. today, I invite you, not just today, for the coming days of the next week, and until I see you again on Monday, Thursday, make this your prayer. Lord, come and see. Lord, come and see. As simple as that. It's as easy to remember as that short verse in the Bible that Jesus weeps. Lord, come and see. Say it with me. Lord, come and see. Over the next 10, 11 days, whenever you're feeling down, whenever you're in doubt, if you have that moment of grief, that moment of pain, make that your prayer. Lord, come and see. Jesus will be there. Amen.
Lifting our voices and turning toward God, let us pray for the church, the earth, and all who are in need. God, our sure strength, set the mind of your church on the spirit of love and kinship. Bring healing where there is division and hope where there is worry. Lord, in your mercy. You bring life where there was despair and death. Bring new hope and new growth to barren lands and water to parched earth. Lord, in your mercy. Listen to the voices of the weak and oppressed. Guard people in all lands from danger and injustice. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Martha and Mary pleaded for healing. Hear the cries of your people who call out in need and pain. Grant healing and comfort to those who are ill. And we pray especially for Henry and Janine, Jim and Claudia, Debbie and John, Chris and Marietta, Bruce and Ron, Cliff and Lisa, Helen and Pat, and we pray for Steve and Kim, Nellie and Willie, Ed, Jeff, and the Cass family, and those that we remember in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bring life to dry bones in our community. Breathe your life-giving spirit into the corners of our ministry that need renewal. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for the faithfully departed. We especially remember Vi and Wayne and Ruth and Margaret, and for the assurance that we will join with them in the heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Into your hands, merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your steadfast love, trusting in you to come and see, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Merciful God, we receive the sacrifice,
praise, and thanksgiving and the offering of our lives, that following in the way of the cross, we may know the joy of the resurrection through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times, in all places, give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ. Praise to you for your Spirit poured out on all nations. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life, and we proclaim the mystery of faith, saying together, "Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again." O Lord of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence. Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us. Send us forth burning with justice, peace, and love. With your holy ones of all times and places, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. for the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Return to God with all your heart. Receive bread for the journey, drink for the desert.
Thank you.
God of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Compassionate God, you have fed us with the bread of heaven. Sustain us in our Lenten pilgrimage. May our fasting be hunger for justice, our alms a making of peace, and our prayer the song of grateful hearts. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Are there announcements to share this morning from the congregation? Yes. Other announcements? May God, who has called us forth from the dust of the earth and claimed us as children of light, strengthen you on your journey into life renewed. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
guided by the gospel.